And to move on to something, sorry, Scott, if I'm stepping your toes off having mentioned this, stop me. But before you go on, my fascination with why things have their titles changed. The Pirates, an Adventure with Scientists, that's a great name because it sounds vaguely ridiculous, and the extra exclamation marks in the title, brilliant. And then in the United States, for some reason, released as The Pirates Band of Misfits, which is a terrible name.
And I very much approve of this title.
Despite what the current executive branch of the United States government may wish, Americans do know what scientists are. They have lots of them. They're quite good at it. So why would you take that name away? It doesn't make any sense to me. No. Americans definitely know what scientists are. It's the same language. Weird choice. I could have just said, now Scott will talk about the Pirates and Adventure with Scientists, but, well, I apparently like the sound of my own voice. So.
I very much approve of the title, which gives a very accurate description of the contents of the film, so much so that no further review is required. 5 stars, says Paul Ross. No, all right then. This Urban Animations outing, also known by the, as you may, vastly inferior title of Pirates Band of Misfits, is based on a series of kids' books that I am unfamiliar with. It introduces us to Hugh Grant's The Pirate Captain and his band of ham-loving piracy enthusiasts, who seem like nice people but awful pirates. Hence their almost complete lack of plunder booty, meaning that Pirate Captain will once again not achieve his dream of being named Pirate of the Year and gaining the approval of Brian Bessett's Pirate King. A pep talk from the ship's number 2, voiced by Tim from The Office, sees Pirates Captain resolve to redouble their efforts, and it seems like their luck might be turning around from another failure when they board David Tennant's young Charles Darwin ship, who recognises that the Pirate Captain's beloved parrot is in fact a dodo, perhaps the last in the world. He says that they could achieve great fame and prizes if only they could go back to London to present Polly at the Royal Society. The only downside, of course, would be heading into, well, London, where Imelda Staunton's Queen Victoria sits, festering in her legendary hatred of the pirates. Will the pirates disguise as scientists hold up? Does Queen Victoria have ulterior culinary motives for the dodo? Will there be wild adventures involving baking soda and vinegar? The answers can only be found by watching this film. Or reading the Wikipedia recap, I suppose, but I recommend that you watch the film instead because it's really quite good indeed. The most important thing to say about this, I suppose, is that it's very funny and consistently entertaining. I roundly applaud the script and the performances. I should also add that it looks wonderful too. As what we've done said with Chicken Run a few weeks back, it's clearly recognisable as an Aardman production, but at the same time, it's a markedly different feel to the other work, just as much as Chicken Run felt distinct from Wallace and Gromit. I think it's mainly static pictures that emphasise Aardman's visual similarities. And I suppose with that foolproof recommendation already given, there's not much more to say about the pirates in Adventure with Scientists, at least until the invention of a time machine that will allow me to go back and shout at people, particularly myself, for not watching this enough back on its release in oversight, which has doomed us to a world where no sequels were made. A great shame, as I would love to see the pirates in an adventure with communists, but such is life. I don't know if it was a surprise exactly. I normally expect decent things from Aardman, but yeah, I hadn't got with this, and I really, really liked this. Yes, very funny. Loved it.
I remember this being released, and for the life of me, I can't work out why I didn't watch it.
Yeah.
Why it took me 8 years to actually get around to seeing it. And again, I've clearly missed out because it's a great deal of fun. While watching this, I was thinking about the what Aardman looking thing. This may be, while it's clearly Aardman, it may be the most individual looking Aardman film. It's the least Aardman-y, if you follow. And I don't think it's just a static image thing, though, Scott, because the real film that had made me say all these things about Aardman in particular was Early Man. And Early Man, everything about it just feels so generic Aardman.
Right.
So it's not just I'm sure it's not just a still thing. Although I should maybe revisit Early Man, see if I have a better experience with it this time around. But this, it's great. Aardman do make some great stuff. I think the only time this film kind of lost my attention a bit was the big action set piece at the end, which is something that most Aardman stuff has to some degree. Even like the Wallace and Gromit shorts, 30-minute shorts. That is more just a thing with me, I think, because in live-action films, I tend to switch off unless it's like a really inventive action scene anyway, because they all seem to go on forever and not have a lot of point, and they don't tend to do an awful lot for me.
Right.
So it's like, that's the only thing. It's like, well, it's this big action scene. I'd have preferred the jokes, to be honest. Could you not just kept the fun bits instead? And now you're just doing a very, very ambitious and very well animated action set piece, but I more or less don't care. I prefer some jokes. And also, like, it's not for the first time I realise now, I really like Hugh Grant, actually.
Yeah.
So the films that first prompted my attention, things that don't interest me at all, Four Winds and Three Notes is a terrible film, and Notting Hill and the persona of Hugh Grant. But I've seen him so many things now that I really, really like him. He's actually, I'm not sure given some of his things he said of late that he's particularly self-aware, but he certainly is willing to kind of make fun of himself. And I kind of feel there's a wee bit of that in the way he portrays the pirate captain in this.
Yeah.
But clearly he's obviously a decent actor. So for me to have dismissed him out of hand in the early 90s, it was clearly unfair. We're not talking like the gentleman level of performance here, or even Paddington 2, but it's a great deal of fun in this. Again, there's always the question with animation, like whether you really need the celebrity cast. But this particular celebrity cast, apart from maybe Imelda Staunton, does pretty well. So I'm pretty happy with it. If there's a downside, there's not enough Brian Blessed, because there is never enough Brian Blessed. You can't have enough Brian Blessed. He's Brian Blessed. Gordon's alive. But yeah, other than that, it's highly recommended. It's a great deal of fun. And Aardman are great. And once again, we see how good their animation is. You do wonder why they ever thought making Flushed Away was a good idea. Let's take all our skill and our trademark looking stuff and then make a CG version of it. Like, why? Like a worse facsimile of what you already do extremely well. What is the point?
Yeah, I suppose it was an experimentation, but I don't know why they did it with Flushed Away and not maybe some more throwaway short that would have been like a half hour or something rather than the full one. Because Flushed Away was all right, but I mean, it didn't have anything like the charm and the heart that the rest of Aardman's stuff does. It's a bit of an outlier in that regard.
Yep.